Happy Sabbath, Church. Today's scripture reading comes from Revelation chapter 1, verse 1 to 3. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Amen.
I think before I introduce the speaker for this morning, let me say thank you so much for coming early today.
Amen.
A short story. When I was in Standard 8, we had a certain guy, my cousin, Robin's heart. He used to get 0 out of 100 all the time, most of the times. If he gets 10, it means it's something big. But there came a time when he got 70%. 70, that means 70 out of 100. The teacher did talk about some of the people who are getting 100 out of 100. He continued talking about 70% that Robin's heart got that day.
Amen.
It was the story of the week. And guess what? He started improving just because the teacher talked about him. I want to say thank you so much. We have not yet come to the 100% punctuality, but today it has made a very great improvement. I might mention that.
Amen.
God bless you. And I want to welcome you all in a special way. And especially the guests who came late, were not introduced, you are so much welcome. May God bless you. In a special way, let me mention Brother and Mrs. Price for coming again.
Amen. Amen.
Would you please stand up? We would like to see you. Amen. What did the church say?
Amen.
This is not for love's God.
Amen.
Sit down. Thank you so much for your coming. I want to introduce the speaker of the day. His name is Pastor Dwayne Campbell. He is coming from Jamaica. He pastored in Jamaica for 5 years, but before he became a pastor, he was an evangelist. You know evangelists, what they do? Preaching the word. And thousands of people were baptized because of his service. He's a great preacher. He's a great preacher. He is now at Andrews in the first year. You might be interested to know, where is his wife? His wife is yet to come, but she is not in yet. So he will be a husband in a few months, but he's still, you know what I'm talking about. Because most people say he's a husband of one, so many children, but not in his case. He's just a youth pastor.
Amen.
Vibrant. Willing to serve the Lord in your youth. Not when you become old and you can't even speak, then you say, I want to be a pastor. But be pastors while you are yet a youth. He is a vibrant pastor. He is a vibrant evangelist. Soon after the special song, we are going to sing Pastor Dwayne Campbell, who is going to preach to us on the blessings from the Lord. May God bless us. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. It's great to be here
Amen.
Today to worship with you
Amen.
At the Michiana, Malawi Church.
Amen.
Did I get it right?
Yes.
Okay. It's a pleasure, and I feel at home.
Amen. Amen.
And I don't know if it's possible. I'm going to see if I can call back home to transfer my membership here.
Amen.
But this is very, very welcoming and very appreciative. And just happy to share in your worship experience. It has been an extraordinary experience so far since I'm here. And I'm happy for your devotion and your commitment to Jesus Christ. I'm encouraged to serve the Lord more, Elder. I'm encouraged to be more affirmed in my decision for Christ based on your experience and your service here. Again, I say thanks to the elders who have made this opportunity possible for me to be here. Thank you very much for this opportunity to stand in the pulpit. And I'm grateful as I move along. My good friend Limbani, we work together on campus, the dairy industry. And he's a wonderful gentleman.
Amen.
I won't disclose him how he works, but I will just leave it there. But he's a good guy. He's a good guy. Good friends as we work together in that particular section. I come to you this morning. Yes, morning. From the book of Revelation. There are 7 blessings there that God wants us to receive as we move forward. 7 blessings of Revelation. And I want these blessings to be your experience today as we move forward in the word of Jesus Christ. Bow your heads with me. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening, and help us to understand your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. There are 7 blessings in the book of Revelation that God wants us to achieve and to encounter today. And I pray by the grace of God that you will have this experience and this encounter. We all know the book of Revelation, a very profound, prolific book. It's a book that is written for God's end time people regarding last day's events. I had the opportunity of interacting with preachers of other religious persuasion, from the Baptists, from the Church of God, from the Pentecostals, and I asked them, what do you think of the book of Revelation? Well, some say, Pastor, it's a closed book. It's not relevant for our time. Spoke to another pastor in the Pentecostal church. He told me that the book of Revelation is a mistake. It's not relevant for us because it is filled with beasts and images and frightening objects that would make you jump out of your seat and run away and run out of church. But when I read the book of Revelation, the word revelation itself contradicts what they are saying. Because the word revelation means to reveal. Amen?
Amen.
The word revelation means to bring to pass. It means to unravel. It means to unseal, to open, to bring to pass that which was enclosed. So the book of Revelation is written for God's people who are his servants. What do you say? But this book was written by none other than John the Beloved. You know John, that disciple that sticks closer to Jesus. Everywhere Jesus was, you could find John. If Jesus was up on the mountain, John was there. When Jesus went into the Garden of Gethsemane and prayed until his sweat became, as it were, drops of blood, you know who was there. Oh yes, John was there. At the point when they apprehended Jesus and placed a cross on him, The other disciples fled in fear and fright, didn't want to associate themselves with Jesus, but John was behind Jesus, and probably John was saying in his heart, should Jesus bear the cross and the world go free? There's a cross for you and there is a cross for me.
Amen.
And so all the way to Calvary, John went with Jesus. What do you say? And as a result of that, John was a powerful leader in the early church. Everywhere John went, the church grew. Everywhere John went, the church was mobilized and energized. And so John stepped into one church and he told them, by this shall all men know that you are God's disciples, if you have love one for another. He stepped into another church that thought that they were well equipped and well arrived. And John said, listen, it doesn't matter how you dress or how you look, but if you say you love God and keep not his commandments, you are a liar. Have mercy, have mercy. And the truth is not inside of you. He went into one church and tell them, behold what manner of love the Father had bestowed on us, so that we can be called sons and daughters of God. And John encouraged the church. But when John was preaching, guess what? His enemies did not like him. Do you know that when you start to live right for Jesus, people are not going to like you? When you stand for truth and principles, you're going to have some enemies. Have mercy. When you start to live right, those who are your friends become your enemies. And even sometimes among your own, there are those who will not like you. But I'm stuck by here to tell somebody in church today, if God is for you, who can be against you? No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty God. Hallelujah. And so the Bible says that John, while he was preaching, his enemies came and said, John, stop preaching. Because we notice as a result of your sermon, the church is growing. As a result of your preaching, the membership is increased. As a result of your preaching, Gentiles are converted to Christianity. As a result of your preaching, the world is made known that there is a God that saves. And so they say, John, if you continue to preach, we're going to put you in a pot of boiling oil. But John say, I don't matter what you may do to this body, because this body you may kill, but the truth abided still. Help me, somebody. You can burn the church. You can burn the members. You can destroy the Bible, but you cannot destroy the truth. Hallelujah. Because as long as God sits on the throne, truth remains truth. I'm happy today, church, that God was not voted into the position of God. And because he was not voted in, nobody can vote him out. He was God before you get here, and he'll be God when you are gone. Because he is from the past, he is present, and bless my heart, he will be God forever.
Amen.
And so the Bible says they took John and they took him to church and they placed him, have mercy. They apprehended him hand and feet and said, John, we told you not to preach, and because you continue to preach, we're going to put an end to your life. And so they took the man of God, ready to dip him in a pot of boiling oil. But hallelujah. I wish I were there, church. Because if I were there, I would tell them, don't do it. And they would say, Pastor Campbell, why should we not do it? I would tell them, you see, in the scripture, oil represents the Holy Spirit. So if you dip the man of God in the pot of oil, you are dipping him in the Holy Ghost. You are dipping him in the Holy Spirit. And so when they dipped the man of God in the pot of oil, hallelujah, John came out filled with the Spirit. Can I tell you, somebody, if God is on your side, no devil in hell can destroy you. If God is on your side, no demon in hell can put an end to you. For the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him. He delivers them. What do you say?
Amen.
And so he came out of the pot of boiling oil. They became amazed. They say, wow, is this a supernatural being? Then somebody said, have mercy. We cannot kill him. Can I tell you? When God says it is finished, your work is not done. In other words, you are immortal until God says it's done. So until it's done, the devil cannot kill you. Have mercy. Until your work is finished, the devil cannot stop you. So you are immortal until God says your work is done. So when they put the man of God in the pot, God said, John, your ministry is not finished. They can't kill him. And so when they took him out, they said, all right, if we can't kill him, what shall we do with him? One of the enemies of God raised his hand and said, if we can't kill him, let us give him solitary confinement. And they say, yes, seconded. All in favor, say aye. They raised and they voted. And they say, well, if John is affecting the church so positively, we're going to alienate him. We're going to segregate him from the church. And so they took John and put him on a barren, desolate island called Patmos, far from the church, far from his family, far from friends, far from his associates. But I've come by church to tell somebody that somebody may separate you from the church. Somebody may separate you from your family. Somebody may separate you from your community. But nobody can separate you from a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They may separate you from the outside, but they can't separate you from the inside. And so when they put him on a barren, desolate island, Jesus was waiting there for him.
Amen.
Because the presence of God is everywhere. What do you say?
Amen.
And let me tell you, I would rather live in the open with Jesus than to live in a palace without him. Because it's the presence of Jesus that makes the difference. It's the presence of Jesus that makes the difference. I remember when I was back home, I was at church one Sabbath when I got a phone call. Pastor, someone needs your presence urgently. I responded to the call and I went to the home of a very wealthy rich man who was dying on his deathbed. And when I went to his home church, when I went to the house where the man was located, it was a big, expensive house. I was distracted by my mission, by the beauty of the house. And so when I went in the house, I was like this. My eyes were everywhere. Wow, what a beautiful mansion. I forgot my mission by the beauty that was around me. I looked around me at everything and the beauty. And then I looked at the floor and the tiles and the expensive design. And somebody tapped me on the shoulder and said, Pastor, he's upstairs. I said, all right, please take me upstairs. And as I ascended the steps and I went upstairs and the maid opened the master bedroom. And when I stepped in, I said, have mercy. This is what heaven must be like. But then, as my eyes met his eyes, I became sober. As my eyes met his eyes, I remember my mission. He turned his eyes and looked at me and said, Pastor, come a little closer. Very rich and wealthy man. As I stepped up to his bedside, he said to me, Pastor, and let me tell you something, church, when he said it, it did something to my heart. This is what he said. He said, Pastor, I'm a wealthy man. I'm one of the most influential men in Jamaica. And he said to me these words, but I would give anything to trade places. Pastor, I would give anything to have what you have. I would give anything to have the relationship with God that you have. And right there and then, church, it came to my mind that that there are some things in life that money can't buy. Hear me, church. There are some things in life that position cannot buy. There are some things in life that wealth cannot give you. There are some things in life that your influence cannot procure. Only the presence of Jesus that makes a difference. And then I prayed for him, church, and right there he lifted his hands and said, I want to accept Jesus. We went back and we gave him a series of studies. And I prayed to God. After that, he died. I hope that his decision was made for eternity. But I'm just letting you know that Jesus makes the difference. What do you say? Amen. All right, quickly now, the first blessing. While John was on the Isle of Patmos, God says, I have 7 blessings for the Malawi church. Have mercy. Right. Let us look at them now quickly. Verse 3, chapter 1. First blessing, it says, blessed is he that what? Readeth. And they that what? Hear the words of this prophecy. And do what? Keep those things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. So what's the first blessing now? The first blessing comes to those who read, who hear. But the problem in the church is not reading. It's not hearing. But keep it. But you cannot get the blessing if you only hear. And say, man, the word was good and preach nice. You cannot get the blessing if you only read. But you get the blessing when you keep those things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. There are many people who know what is right, but they don't do what is right. And so the Bible says you cannot get the blessing until you keep. What do you say? Amen. And so the second blessing goes to Revelation chapter 14. 7 blessings we had. We're going to the second one now. Revelation chapter 14. Quickly. Revelation chapter 14 gives us the next blessing. 14 verse 12. It says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that what? Keep the commandments of God. And what do they have? The faith of whom? Here is the blessing now. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write. Here is the word. Blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. Yea, said the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. This blessing, in order to get this one, you have to die. This one is for the dead, not for the living. But it says, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Why are they blessed? Because those who die in the Lord, they will be a part of a special resurrection. Right now, the dead in Christ, let me tell you, sometimes, church, when I look at life, I wonder sometimes if death is more preferable to life. Because those who die in the Lord, they are, as it were, sleeping. They are free from trials. Amen? Free from heartaches. Free from challenges. Free from temptation. And the next time their eyes are open, they are looking in the face of Jesus. So the dead in Christ are blessed. Because precious in the sight of the Lord are the death of his saints. What do you say? So there's a blessing for the dead in Christ. And that brings us now to the next blessing. Quickly, chapter 16. Chapter 16, verse 15. Next blessing, it says, behold, I come as a thief. Here is the word now. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. So a blessing comes to those who are covered in the righteousness of Jesus. You know, sometimes as Christians, we have become so famous in our acting. Have mercy. Is that we know when to put on and how to take off. And so, when sunset on Sabbath, we take off Adventism and Christianity. And we hang it up in the wardrobe and then we take out worldliness. And for 6 days we dress like the world, we talk like the world, we look like the world, we identify with the world, and there is no distinction in our talk and in our habits. And when it comes to sunset on Friday evening, we go home and take off back worldliness.
Amen.
And take out back Adventism and puts it on and sing, I love thee, my Lord, have mercy. But the Bible says a blessing comes to those who walks in the righteousness of Jesus. In other words, wherever you go, you wear the righteousness of Christ. At school, you're righteous. At work, you're righteous. At play, you're everywhere you go, Jesus can be seen.
Amen.
And so there's a blessing to those who watch and keep their garments. What do you say?
Amen.
Next blessing takes us to chapter 19. Quickly now. 19 verse 9 brings us to blessing number what? Are you counting? What blessing is this now? Very good. Number 4:9. And he said unto me, right. Here is that word. Blessed are they which are what? Called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, these are the true sayings of God. So there's a blessing comes to those who respond to the call and say, Lord, I surrender. Lord, I respond to the call. I'm not too busy to say yes to Jesus. I'm not too preoccupied to let the will of God be done in my life. Yes, Lord, enter and have full control. Revelation 20 verse 6 brings us to the next blessing. 20 verse 6 brings us to the next blessing. It says, blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection, and such the second death hath no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Revelation 22 verse 7 brings us to blessing number 6. Blessing number 6. Behold, I come how? How is Jesus coming, church? Here is the word now. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And the last blessing is in the same chapter. Who can tell me which verse? Same chapter. But verse 14. Very good school. Very good. Verse 14. Last blessing. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. These are the 7 blessings of Revelation. And I pray to God that we will make these blessings our realities and allow Jesus to dwell within and his spirit to guide. The Lord bless you as we worship together.
Thank you. blessings of revelation to be my personal experience. I want to surrender my heart to Jesus before it's too late, so that I will be on the side of grace. Is there such a one? Just raise it. I'm not yet baptized, not yet surrendered. Probably your sister is here today, and you want this decision. God bless you, my sister. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? Yes, I see another hand. God bless you. God bless you. And there's another hand over this side. Oh, God bless you. God bless you as we pray. Loving Lord, we thank you for today. We're happy for the dispensation of grace. We're happy for the love of Jesus. Oh God, we pray that you will encircle us now with your divine presence. And help us, Lord, to live consistent lives so that those around us will see Jesus within and come to worship you. Bless us, we pray. Guide us, we pray. And may the blessings of the Sabbath become the blessing of your people as we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, and everybody say,
Amen. Amen.